My name is Zoltan Takacs. I'm a biomedical scientist. I follow my childhood passion. This is actually can be seen as a gold mine for medicine. There are not only snakes and scorpions which are venomous. There are a whole lot of different kinds of other types of animals, This could be seen as a gold mine for medicine. There are 150,000 different species of venomous animals out there. 150,000. And they have an estimated 20 million toxins in their venom. 20 million toxins which hasn't been looked by science. So it's a huge potential. Why? Because venoms have been tweaked by evolution for millions and millions of years to immobilize and kill a prey or predator in less than 1 minute. So how they do it? The venom contains like 50, 100, 200 different toxins, and those toxins target very important molecules in the body, like ion channels, receptors, enzymes, and so on. Those molecules also the same type of molecules which you need to take under control to treat diseases. So this is why animal venom toxins are such a good template for new medicines, because they naturally target those targets which you need to take under control for therapeutic applications. They tend to bind with high affinity, and they show a reasonable amount of selectivity. So, you know, the side effect is not that big of a problem. Of course, you know, it's not all toxin is ready-made for a medicine, so that's why, you know, our work and other people's work needed to be done, but they're excellent templates. Two of the top medicines used for the most lethal types of heart attacks coming from snake venom. One coming from the pygmy rattlesnake from North America, and the other one comes from the carpet viper, which you find distributed from North Africa, Middle East, all over to India. So it's fascinating, India. So today, about 20 different medications are derived from animal venom toxins, and they're treating like heart attack, high blood pressure, heart failure, thrombosis, diabetes, chronic pain. It's actually quite interesting that how many different types of diseases could be potentially treated by animal venoms. And the answer for this, and the reason for this, is because toxins have been evolved for millions of years to immobilize and kill prey and predator. So they target different parts of the body, like the cardiovascular system, the blood circulation, and the nervous system, the communication between the nerve and the muscle cells. They shut down those two systems, so they immobilize and kill prey and predator. So what we do, we create toxin libraries for validated target. So let's say there is a potassium channel, and the potassium channel can be a validated target for many different types of diseases. So you have a subtype of potassium channel, and you know that you want to have a specific molecule which only blocks this potassium channel, doesn't touch anything else, so you do not have side effect. So what we do, we go out and see what kind of animal species, scorpions or marine creatures, have potassium channel toxins in their venom by the result of evolution. We get those toxins, and then we create a combinatorial library where we create mosaic toxins, mixing bits and pieces and bits from different type of toxins into one. And now we can create like a library of a million, 2-3 million variants, toxin variants, and we screen which one will be very selective for that particular subtype of potassium channel which you want to take under control to treat a disease. So what we do, we extract the genetic blueprint. So our work is based on the genetic blueprint of the toxins, either the DNA or the RNA sequence, because we can actually, using bioinformatics, we can design the library, so we know every single toxin variants what we create in a library which holds, let's say, 2 million toxins. We are exactly know what goes into that library, and then we can put these DNA pieces artificially into bacteria, and the bacteria will make as much toxins as we wish. So it's actually quite interesting. So we can re-engine. So what we actually do, we improve on nature. We improve, what we actually do, we improve on nature to develop a potential life-saving medication. Well, it's risky. I follow my childhood passion. I've been bitten a number of times by snakes, and all of them are my fault. I became allergic to the snake venom and to the snake antivenom, so I'm really in a least good position to be a venom researcher, but I enjoy what I'm doing. I try to make every precautions to avoid any major accident, and I don't like to take risk. So I always try to keep the risk at a minimum, and it's never going to be a comfortable minimum, but it's a workable minimum. Well, we use all kinds of high-tech equipment to catch snakes, like a wooden stick and shorts. But it's basically what you need. In order to operate in this field, you need three things. You need a driving force, which some people would call a little bit craziness, but you need a passion, a driving force. You want to do, you know, you need that. So that's number one. Number two, you need the knowledge. You know, a knowledge what you earn during your schooling and your experience doing working in this field. So you need driving force, the knowledge, and you need the tools. You need the tools, you know, which includes, you know, the actual research tools, what you do, your work, either in the field or in the laboratory, you know, financial background also included. So you need these three. And if you have these three in place, then it's really just your mind and your vision is the limit. So what we do, we specialize to create a toxin tech, we specialize to create the largest toxin libraries in the world. Let's say you have a validated target for a disease. Let's say you have a validated target for a particular disease, but there is not a molecule which selectively blocks that target. So then we come into the picture and see, all right, so let's see what kind of animal toxins has been designed by nature to target that molecule, but they may not be the perfect fit as of yet, you know, to make it into a medicine. So we get those kind of toxins which already evolution made to sort of aim that particular molecule, and then we create a combinatorial library. We create a million, 2 million variants, and then we are able to screen that out of that million, million plus variants, which is the best fit for a potential, And after that, then we are able to screen these libraries that out of this million plus variants, which is the molecule which best fits to the target and could be potentially turned into a future medicine. So or work, you also have to realize that in order to develop a new medicine from scratch, it takes about 10 to 15 years. So we are at the very early upstream discovery phase of this long, long process. We are the ones who are looking for molecules which could be potentially turned into a medicine. After you isolate from the library, you're holding a hit in your hand, and then you have to characterize, you have to sort of test, you know, in biochemical and physiological experiments to make sure that this is what you're looking for. Now the hit turns into a lead, and then you put that lead molecule into, you know, into medicinal chemistry, you put into animal models and so on. And then if everything looks fine, then a couple of years later you can push it into clinical trials. So it is a very long process. We are at the very beginning. We are identifying potential molecules which target those receptors, ion channels, and enzymes which has to be taken under control to treat a disease.